welcome to the very first episode of Queenpod, Squee, with some wonderful people that we're going to be discussing all things Queen with and work through the albums, and it's going to be wonderful stuff. So without any further ado, on drums and soprano, our musical expert, comedian Suze Kempner.
Hello.
Hey Suze, how are you?
I'm all good, thank you. I like being called an expert.
Exactly, an expert you will be. And you are.
And sure.
on bass, we've got the quiet man of Queenpod, Mr. Simon Lupton.
I'm very happy with being on bass. Hello, thank you. That's all you'll get from me.
Okay, thank you, Simon. That's a quiet man for you. And on lead guitar and vocals, the mighty John Robbins. Hi, John.
Hey, man, I'm happy with that. I was sort of worrying where I might be on stage, but I'm pleased with Brian.
And there's me, Ro. So,
doesn't that make you Freddy?
Hey,
oh my God!
How convenient!
Because I'm the only person of colour in the group. No,
fair enough.
2020. That's just a coincidence. Hey, we're all Freddy, guys. We're all Freddy. I'm going to cut all of this bit out. So, the first thing I thought we've got a format point to kick off with, which is Queen are the champion.
We are the champions.
One of the things that we thought would be really nice to do is just all of us, every now and then Queen just will pop into your lives in the most unexpected and lovely ways. And it happened for me recently. I've been doing the Pegasus watching order of the MCU movies, the Marvel movies, which I highly recommend doing. And I was watching Iron Man 2, which is not the strongest of films, but in this new watching order, it's not bad. But that's for a different podcast. My point is, halfway through the film, Iron Man gets a massive drunken fight with War Machine at his birthday party. And just before the fight kicks off, Iron Man turns to the DJ and says, DJ, drop me a fat beat. And what does he drop? He drops Another One Bites the Dust.
Ah.
And it's so awesome. And I kind of wasn't really watching the fight because I was just so into just Freddie belting it out. You know, it was just that was my little Queen moment that happened to me. This week. Has anyone got any others?
I've got one, from the bass department, if I can. as we all know, next year is so 2021 is officially the 50th anniversary of Queen, because the 40th anniversary was celebrated in 2011, and so that's how it works. 10 years later, you do the 50th, and because it's marked at the point where John joined Brian, Roger and Freddie, and the sort of the lineup of Queen was completed, so that's why it's sort of marked as the beginning of Queen. But obviously we all know that Queen existed in some shape or form before then, with Brian, Roger and Freddie and a number of different bass players playing gigs, and the name Queen had been chosen. So the embryonic stage of Queen, if you like, started in 1970, officially sort of became Queen in 1971. So I was drawn, it was drawn to my attention that during 1970 they played some of these early gigs, and one of them was at a college in Hertfordshire. Now I grew up in Hertfordshire, and until that point I thought Hertfordshire's main claim to Queen fame was that, of course, Nebworth is in Hertfordshire, where Freddie played his last ever gig with Queen. But it turns out that they were also home to one of the first Queen gigs that Freddie did. And in fact, they were actually booked as Smile. But when they turned up, they were they'd changed their name to Queen. So anyway, basically, if you go onto the fantastic website, queenconcerts.com, there's a little sort of description of the concert. And I wanted to read a bit of that, because there was a description by this guy called David Cripps, who was the drummer in the support band for Queen on that day. And he writes, I was a student at Balls Park College, Hertford. As a college band, we played at every gig and supported every act that played at the college. We were called Full Frontal Nudity, named after a Monty Python sketch. And we were the support band to the band booked that night for the Winter Ball, which was Smile. I remember them arriving and announcing that they had just played the Cavern Club in Liverpool and were playing that night under their new name, Queen. So we played our first set, and as we left the stage, they took their places on stage. We shook hands as we passed each other, watched them, wished them luck, etc. They played their set, and then we passed them again as we took the stage to play our second set. I would love to say that I could see in embryo form the legends that they were to become, but that would not be true. I remember thinking they were really good, and I watched some of their set, but there was a girl that I was after, and she occupied much of my attention. He goes on to say, later, my band changed its name to Rainbird and was one of the few bands in those days that would play Bohemian Rhapsody. One of our agents knew the Queen guys, and we were told they wanted to see us do it live. So we were told they would come to a club in Essex that we played regularly, and we were amazed one Saturday night to see Brian May and Roger Taylor standing at the bar, and they chatted to us backstage after that set, which I thought was a lovely story.
Yeah.
It struck me that the county that I grew up in, you know, was at the beginning of Queen and also at the end of Queen with Freddie as a live act. But the one little footnote to that story is that in 1980, when I was at junior school, so I would have been about nine, I was in a class called 3C, and the C stood for Cripps. So David Cripps, who was the drummer in Full Frontal Nudity, was my teacher in the third year at junior school.
No really? Way.
Yes.
Oh, that's
so
amazing.
That is 6 degrees of separation to Queen.
Wow.
I was taught by the drummer of the support act of one of their first gigs.
That's phenomenal.
And I was reminded of that this week. So I think it'd be great if anyone else out there has stories of those, how close they came to being connected to Queen, however tenuous it might be. I'd love to hear
them. Oh, we could call it 7 degrees of rye.
There you
are. Lovely.
That's it.
I'm writing that down, John. Is he the reason you started playing drums as well then?
I think it might have been, actually, because I didn't start playing until I got into secondary school, but I definitely think I must have looked at that and thought, if I'm ever going to be in a band, I want to be the drummer.
Right.
And, yeah, certainly him and probably Roger, I would say.
Roger would have been a bigger influence.
Maybe, but let's say they're on a par. I'm sure they...
Yeah, Roger Taylor and Dave Cripps.
There you go. He actually contacted me after Days of Our Lives documentary came out and said, I don't know if you know this, but... And I was like, I wish I'd known that, because we would have interviewed
you would have
him.
Put it in
But I love the honesty of it. The fact that he was like going, I didn't feel like I was witnessing the birth of what would become one of the greatest bands ever, because he was more interested in the girl in the crowd, which is how a drummer should be.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Drummers are. We should totally get him on the podcast sometime.
I'm sure he'd love to.
Amazing. Just to say, actually, while we're waiting to move on to our next format point, we are in July 2020, so we are still recording this remotely and, doing it by Zoom and blah de blah. So if you hear the odd police siren or cat wailing or, in my case, a piano player pianoing, that's my mum. So let's...
Can we, just a point of order, can we call them features and not format points? It sounds quite...
it's like a meeting.
Yeah.
Okay. I will strike format points off the agenda. So our next format point, feature, is called Love of Our Lives, because Queen are the love of our lives. Want to hear from all of you. Actually, we have an email address, which is queenpod@thequeenpodcast.com, and you can also get us at the Queenpod on Insta and Twitter. We would love to hear from you about how you got into Queen. If you've got any questions for us to debate, chat about, talk about, stuff like that. So for this episode, we've got a little thing from John Worsey from Southsea, who's told us exactly why he got into Queen and what it means to him. And he's also given us a question for us to have a chat about. So I will read you what he sent us. The first Queen song I knowingly heard was The Invisible Man. I loved it because it was about an invisible man. I was 9 years old. I'd been too young for Queen to be a formative band, the musical love of my life, but that's what they became anyway. It's because of Queen that I play guitar and write songs. It's because of Queen that I love so many different kinds of music. Queen could give you rock, pop, metal, opera, ballads, funk, musical, all on one album. Why can't other bands do that? Because no other band is Queen, that's why. In the 3 decades since, I've come back to Queen again and again. I find more in their music each time. My favourite albums and songs change as I grow. They are a gift that keeps giving. When I first got into Queen back in 92, they were my joy and comfort as my parents split up. They gave me a whole world of art to escape into. In 2019, as my mother-in-law was taken by cancer, I found that I could listen to nothing but Queen for months. Save me, they have, they do.
Aww.
That's it, really, isn't it? That's
that Queen could have been written by me. That's the first song I heard was Breakthrough. My parents broke up in 89. I got into them in late 91. I like this guy, and he's called John.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
That was a really, really nice email.
It's so lovely.
I think sort of sums up, it's a quite a good starting point, sums up probably where a lot of people are at with their music.
But also, what a great thing, this Invisible Man being the entry point. I mean, if you could have...
It is a great song for kids, isn't it?
It is, but it's just a great example of how there are so many ways into Queen. It doesn't have to be sort of the big classic, you know, Bohemian Rhapsodies or Love of My Life or, you know, We Will Rock You, We're the Champions. It can be, you know, Invisible Man from 1989. That's just as good a way into Queen as any other track. And I'm sure Roger will be delighted.
So here's John's question. From Queen to Hot Space in just 9 years, Queen went on a massive musical journey. Is there a Queen song from the 80s that you think could fit on the first album?
Oh, my God.
Oh, that's a great question.
Isn't that a good question?
Wow.
Because Innuendo, I don't think we can include Innuendo because that's post-80s.
It's 90s, yeah.
And there is a lot in Innuendo that sounds like Queen 1. Like, there's a lot of sort of connectivity between those two albums in a really lovely way.
Yeah.
But,
That's one of the best questions I've ever heard in my life.
Isn't it great?
It is a great question.
It's like you'd pull it out of a... box of conversation starters at dinner parties.
Can I offer
with Queen fans?
Can I offer up I Want It All?
I want it all. I want it all. I want it all. And I want it now. I want it.
That to me felt like going back to their roots. But perhaps not Queen 1 though, but certainly. Oh, it's a hard one, isn't it?
It's heavy, but it's still not the right answer.
There's a right answer.
I wonder, now this could be controversial, if there's something of Calling All Girls in that early smile kind of doing all right vibe.
Mm-hmm.
From Hot Space.
I wonder if a sort of an acoustic version of Calling All Girls
might have that Night Comes Down feel. Or...
Yeah, I don't know though.
Mm.
No, that's still not the right answer. Suze, come on. You're going to get this.
The first thing that came to my head, because I instantly went to the works, was Tear It Up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We gotta tear it up, stir it up, rain it up, baby. We gotta tear it up, shake it up, make it up as you go. Tear it up, yeah. Swear it up, yeah. Wake it up, baby. Tear it up, stir it up, stake it up.
I feel like if that had opened Queen 1 instead of Keep Yourself Alive, I wouldn't have gone, what?
No, yeah. Good shout.
But again, it's got that sort of tin drum. So it is got that sort of, because they were heavily into that So they've started to experiment with electronic sounds by that point, I think. So I think the right answer, which is the right answer, is Princes of the Universe.
And here we are, we're the Princes of the Universe. Here we belong, fighting for survival. We've got to be the rulers of you all.
Princes of the Universe, man. Like, lyrically, it's on point for all the kind of mystic fairy world stuff that they are going on about. It's got it's a crazy song, with loads of different parts in it. It almost doesn't repeat itself at any point, and it is raw and operatic and bananas. And I think Princes of the Universe could sit on Queen One very, very easily.
Actually, well, I think you're right. I would say, because you reminded me of the Magic album, Give Me the Prize if it didn't have the clips of the Kurgan in it.
I know his name.
I'm the master of your destiny.
That early guitar solo wouldn't be out of place with Great King Rat.
That's true.
Oh yeah, I
considered it, but I still went with Prince's because of its crazy shift.
Mm.
But yeah, Give Me the Prize is heavy. But is it even half a track without the villain from the movie Highlander? you know, shouting various things like, you know.
Well, how's this for?
I've forgotten all of the things he said.
7 degrees of Rye.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. great feature point.
My fiance's sister has directed a film, which is currently awaiting release when cinemas return. And the father in the film is played by Clancy Brown.
Oh, wow.
And Emerald, my fiance sister, said he was absolutely lovely. And I just kept doing his voice, and it got quite annoying. His voice from Highlander.
It's better to burn out than to fade away, or whatever he says. I love that movie so much.
That's great.
He's amazing. At any time Clancy Brown turns up in a thing,
he's great, isn't he? Because he plays only can think of him playing terrible people, but he does seem like a very nice man.
Yeah, he turns up in The Mandalorian being badass, and
does he?
Yeah, he's obviously he's the drill instructor in Starship Troopers, which is a film that everyone should see.
Yeah,
and then he's one of the main characters in Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah,
yes.
He's the guard.
Yeah, he is the head warden guard, wasn't he? Yeah.
But first and foremost, he is the Kurgan.
He's the Kurgan.
Inspiration of Give Me the Prize. Well, that was a good feature point, wasn't it?
Great question.
Great question.
How lovely. What a brilliant, brilliant question. Thank you very much, John Worsey from Southsea. You are appreciated. And please, please, we want to hear from you. If you want to share anything about your relationship with Queen and how much you know, what they might mean to you, and particularly if you've got a really fun question for us to debate, we love this stuff. This is num 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 for us. We have been nattering away, and we haven't even got into the tracks yet. So this is the main bulk of the. This is our purpose. We've reached the format feature status update point, which I have called the works. And what we're going to do now is we're going to do a deep dive, I hope, on side A of Queen, which was released on the 13th of July, 1973, on EMI and Elektra, recorded at Trident Studios and Delaney in London, and all done on downtime from other bands that were recording. So they were getting free studio time, but they were having to go in at like 1 in the morning and stuff like that, right? We're going to look at the side A, which was Keep Yourself Alive, Doing All Right, Great King Rat, Mad... Well, we'll talk about Mad the Swine along the way, and My Fairy King, which is a wonderful, wonderful, happy thing. First of all, Suze, this is one of your favourite Queen albums, right?
Yeah, I really love the first two albums, and this was... When I decided, oh, I'm super into Queen, I went, I'm going to buy the albums in order when I've got the money do so. So I just turned 15 when I bought this, and I was in a production of Guys and Dolls, the Harlequin Theatre, Red Hill. And I can remember sitting cross-legged on the dressing table, on the makeup table in my dressing room with my big headphones on, listening to this on a Discman and just thinking, huh, everyone around me doesn't know how cool I am. I'm listening to early Queen. There's probably only 100 people who've heard this stuff. So that was, yeah. I've got a real distinct memory of that, and hearing Liar for the first time, just going like, none of these girls know what I'm listening to.
So what was it about this album that got you? Is compared to all the other Queen albums, is it just
I'm really into origin stories anyway, so like, an early album is like, this is their origin story, even though it isn't, because I've since got that bootleg CD, Queen in Noose, some weird Italian CD. I remember getting that in HMV a couple of years later, and so that's their origin story really. But you can hear on this album where everything on the Greatest Hits album comes from, both the Greatest Hits albums, so you can hear where that all came from on this first album.
Yeah. There's a lot of DNA. I'm sure we'll get into that. Wonderful stuff. Why don't we pile in and actually start with Keep Yourself Alive, which is written by Brian May. It's about 3 minutes 47 seconds long, and it didn't it was their single off this album, which didn't chart, but in 2008 Rolling Stone magazine rated the song 31st on its list of 100 greatest guitar songs of all time,
cool,
even though it never charted, which is lovely. There's a few bits that I want to listen to. I think let's listen to the opening first, shall we? Because definitely. It's just, it's, you know, this is why it's a great guitar song right here. This is one of the greatest. That is the introduction to all of Queen for most people, right? That is, if you want to start at the beginning with us and listen to all these tracks in order and have a great old time because you watched a movie or whatever and want to find out more, what a way. That's just
it is a hell
beautiful.
Of an intro to an album, isn't it? First album. Yeah.
How many guitar layers are there?
Lots.
I remember like when I first listened to that, listening to it on headphones, and sorry to date myself, but on a cassette Walkman, Susie. So you're very young.
I was like,
it was like feeling in that opening guitar section that the music was actually like moving from one headphone to the other, which I just never imagined before. And you can, like now, obviously, you can work out how they do that, and you can research what Brian was doing with his guitar and with the overdubs and on so many different Queen songs. But that experience of thinking, this is actually alive, this sound that's going from one ear to the other and then back again. And also I think like lyrically, it's such a great introduction because it basically is saying, this is what's brought us here, and covering a lot of what we were talking about in terms of their sort of struggle in sort of 1970 and 71 and 72. It feels like Freddie is saying, I've done all this stuff and it almost broke me, but we're here now and we're here to stay.
And it's worth it. In fact, it's a song for the times, actually. I found an immensely reassuring song to be listening to through this pandemic situation we've been dealing with at the moment, and it's hugely relevant. The other thing that I love about actually a lot of stuff on this album is it actually feels really current. By current, I mean, like, I wouldn't be surprised if a band like, this is, they're not necessarily that current, but say like the Arctic Monkeys, when they were kicking around, what, five, six, 7 years ago, you know, if they were to put a song out like this, everyone would be just like humming along, just perfectly happy. You know, it's got a real edge to it. And you're right. I think they, right from the off, from the very first strains of this album, you hear that they are pushing the envelope in every which way they can, like making the most out of what a studio can do.
Yeah.
Tell you what I'd like to hear is a sort of a spoken, like, rapped version by The Streets.
Yeah.
I think that would be a really interesting way of hearing Keep Yourself Alive.
Yeah, with bags of pathos.
What's interesting to me is that we're all sort of involved in essentially sort of making content, you know, so I make TV programs and you guys sort of do radio podcasts or, you know, stand-up comedy and so forth. And the thing is, whenever you start anything new, the one bit of advice you always get is you have to have complete confidence, because if the audience hint at any, get any hint of that you're unsure about what you're doing, they'll smell that fear and it won't come across. And when you listen to that, that is a band supremely confident in what they're doing. It's such a we're here opening, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I just think for the first track on a first album to be that sure. I mean, they talk about later sort of, you know, how they always started building songs. It was piano, bass and drums. That's how they would lay the foundation of a song. And I think there's something to be said about that connection between Roger and John, as you know, speaking on behalf of John Deacon here, that connection between
Deacon John,
sorry, Deacon John, yes, at this point, when you that the way that those two locked in and gave you that solid bass to build on, and you hear it right from the beginning of that song, the drums and bass are absolutely locked together. They, you know, that I think is what makes it work so well, is that sheer confidence and expertise at the beginning.
It's a really enduring song.
If you take their 70s albums, each one starts with just such a statement of intent.
Yeah.
Whether that's the sort of quieter, regal confidence of Procession on Queen 2, or the bravery and of Brighton Rock, or the sort of Death on Two Legs as that huge, like, line in the sand of saying we're sort of free from our awful old management. Yeah. And then Tie Your Mother Down is such a big song, and is probably has a sort of similarity with Keep Yourself Alive, as it starts with that sort of solo guitar piece.
That's it.
So they were very good at they're very good at opening albums.
Yeah.
Well, they were just,
you know, we Will Rock You on News of the World. They put some of their most meaningful stuff up front.
Mm-hmm. They're such a theatrical band, aren't they? You know, they did think in terms of drama.
Yeah, it's like structuring an album like it's a show.
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah, that's exactly right. Yeah. Look, there are a couple of bits on this track that I absolutely adore. My personal favourite bit that I do, I was going to play maybe that drum solo into the guitar solo bit, because I just think that's really fun. But here we go. Incredible. Absolutely incredible. I just, you know, it's not like Roger does huge numbers of drum solos, but in that one in particular, it's just got such a journey to it. And then when the guitar solo kicks in at the end of it, it's just, There's so much momentum going into that, right?
Yeah, and considering it's their, this is their opening track on their opening album, they weren't afraid to go, right, we're going to go full Queen with right. this guitar solo. It's literally, yeah. it's like Roger goes, over to you, Brian. And
yeah.
It's like full Red Special guitar solo. This it's unmistakably Queen.
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
It existed, and the song kind of existed before Freddie... was on board, but you can hear where he's had input. Like, no one would do a key change down a key. That doesn't happen, but they go for it. They're like,
oh, really?
We're just gonna go down and then we'll go back up. Yeah. In their opening song on their first album, they're not playing it safe.
Oh my God.
That's great.
Is it a complex song musically?
It is for what it sounds like on paper, which is a cool rock song from the early 70s, but that's what it is on paper, but it is quite complex. There's like definite sections to it, but it's, you'd never like liken it to Bohemian Rhapsody, but you can hear the Freddie's rule breaking arrangements are already coming into play.
Right.
I think also some of Queen's complexity is quite deep in the song and how it's recorded. So they're not a band that play around with crazy time signatures or sort of really confusing phrasing of stuff. It's more how complex it is to build that sound up. So an awful lot of their sort of the iceberg of a Queen song is so much has gone on before to make that song almost sound simpler than it is. I think I would say. So it's not like, you know, if you listen to a Frank Zappa song, and I we'll probably mention him more than you would want over the next 20 weeks.
Well, you already have.
but his songs are insanely complex as you hear them, and you can tell that the musicians playing them are within an inch of what musicians are capable of doing live. Whereas I don't think Queen were necessarily in that situation. They were more of a studio complex band as opposed to a necessarily live complexity.
Mm-hmm. We need to move on really, but there's just one tiny bit from this song that I think is one of the coolest bits in all of Queen that I desperately want to play. I'm not saying this should be considered for the Ultimate Queen playlist, but my God, what a track. I think you guys know what I'm going to play. I know you do, Suze. Here we go. Do you think you're better every day? No, I just think I'll do just the road through my grave. Now, how stone cold is that? A little bit of Rog, a little bit of Brian, and they sound so cool. It's so they're so laid back.
You can tell from certain live moments, early Doors, and on Queen One, that Freddie's voice hasn't reached its destination yet.
Mm-hmm.
But Roger is actually, if you were sort of listening to that, you'd think, well, he's the natural singer.
Yeah.
Because he sounds like a rock singer.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Freddie doesn't quite sound like a rock singer. He sounds like they've sort of got their sort of classical singer to try and do a rock album,
right?
Which is obviously brilliant, but in that clip is a good example of, you think, well, Roger's the singer, because that just sounds like such a cool rock voice.
Yeah, he sounds like Starscream. He's amazing. That is a Decepticon. You're absolutely right. I absolutely adore Roger's voice. It is just one of the coolest voices ever.
In any other band, he's the lead singer,
right?
Like, He's got that Paul Rogers, Robert Plant, almost Axl Rose as well. They've all got that voice that fits in that particular mold, and he's got such an amazing rock voice, and it's great that he gets solo songs on some of the albums, and of course he's got his own solo releases. But it's weird to imagine that this band had essentially three really great singers in it, but their voices go together perfectly.
Yeah. It's only really since I started the podcast that I fully accepted that it was three singers and that Deacon John was not one.
Deacon John not singing. There's one song he sings on. I was reading about it the other day. I can't remember. It's on this album, but it's the only song he's
That's
ever
right,
contributed.
Right.
It was Liar, wasn't it? I think
to.
Liar.
Was it on Liar? Right.
Apparently,
right.
Yeah. We should actually point out to people who are sort of coming to this new, why we keep referring to him as Deacon John. because if you get the Queen album and as a physical product so you can actually look at it, I was reminded of this when I dug out my old vinyl copy just ahead of this, is that when you see the credits of the band named at the back, so you know Freddie Mercury is there, he's already Freddie Mercury, so he's already changed his name from Farouk Balsara, so he's known from Freddie right from the go. Brian May is still Brian May and will always be Brian May, God bless him. Roger is down as Roger Meadows Taylor, that was his full name, and I love about it now is if you see his drum cases to this day, they've still stamped with RMT across them, which is a nice little nod to that. But John Deacon is down as Deacon John because they all thought that would make him sound more interesting. And so they changed his name around, which he hated. And I think maybe what might have been the thing that persuaded him to put his foot down as the quiet member of the band and go, no, is that if we do listen to the Golders Green show later on, which was the first I think recorded concert of Queen that exists, they are introduces and Deacon John on bass, and I think he must have heard that and gone, no I'm not doing this anymore. That's it.
Okay, so I found this little bit, I've got a little bit of a lead in, but yeah, we found this brilliant intro. So I think this guy is introducing them live in the
hall,
the room, because people are responding, but here we go.
There you are, that was Ogre Battle, another new number from Queen. That was a Freddie Mercury composition, and that's being recorded for the new album. Very fine bunch of lads they are, you know. We've got Freddie Mercury on vocals. Roger Meadows Taylor on percussion. Deacon John on bass. And Brian May on guitar. All right. We're moving on with another number that's featured on the Queen album, the first album.
That's brilliant.
That's the most lacklustre response.
Yeah. Fantastic.
So, Simon, is that the oldest, is that the earliest recording of Queen with John Deacon called Queen live?
Officially, sort of properly recorded. I think there might be bootlegs, but I'd have to sort of dig in. But that was recorded by the BBC, so it's like properly recorded.
Yeah.
Again, not a voice you're going to hear on Six Music.
He's really kind of like a parody, isn't he? Yeah. That's proper smashy and nice. Fine bunch of lads.
Fine bunch of lads.
I like the idea that they were like, even the audience are kind of just like, yay. They're not that excited.
No.
I think that's probably the recording more than anything.
Let's assume.
The idea they go, and Roger Meadows Taylor on drums, and just loads of girls going,
that is true. Yeah, to this day, my sister keeps telling me about that issue.
I'll tell my Deacon John anecdote,
please.
Which still bugs me to this day. So I was writing on 8 out of 10 Cats, and every lunchtime we'd play this thing called the birthday game, where someone reads out the name and the description of someone from the Times birthdays, and you have to guess how old they are, and you get 2 points for bang on and 1 point for a year either side. So Richard Osman came in, and I'd never met Richard before, but I was wearing probably this Queen t-shirt. Should point out I'm the only one of us wearing their One t-shirt.
All right, but I was going to put my Flash t-shirt on, but lockdown hasn't been that kind to my waistline.
It's not the Flash episode. Okay, I've got the right t-shirt for the right episode.
Well done. All right.
But well done. So Richard Osman comes in and sits down and sees the t-shirt, and because he's can't stop quizzing, he just said, oh, are you a Queen fan? I said, yeah, I'm a huge Queen fan. And he said, okay, then, who was the first bassist to appear on a Queen album? And I'm thinking, this is a trick question.
Hmm.
And I'm the guy with all the Queen facts, so why don't I know the answer to this trick question? And I was sort of racking my brains. And I went for Mike Gross, thinking that I could at least in defeat, prove that I had a good Queen fact about an earlier Queen bassist. And then he said, no, he's actually credited as Deacon John. I was like, I knew that fact. You out-Queen facted me, and you're not even the Queen fan. You're Richard Osman, the quiz man.
It's like Celebrity Mastermind all over again.
No. There has to be a klaxon every time you mention Celebrity Mastermind. No.
Is that genuinely a sore point? Because I love teasing you about it, but... I love it all the more if it is a genuine sore point.
There are several sore points. No sore point involved with Richard Osman teaching me a new Queen fact. Several sore points with Celebrity
it's
Mastermind.
Really good to know.
We won't go into that. We'll go into them on the Celebrity Mastermind episode part one of four.
Writing that down. So track two is an absolute banger, Doing All Right, which I adore. Everyone adores, don't they?
Yeah.
Yesterday, my life was in ruin. Now today, I know what I'm doing. Got a feeling I should be doing all right.
I love this track. I think it's great. The fact that it could be a ballad and then a heavy rock track all in the same short period of time is just so Queen. It's so fact. It's sort of like a microcosm of everything that's brilliant about Queen. But yes, we were interviewing Taylor Hawkins for the Show Must Go On documentary, who is one of those people who. I think, you know, musicians must get to the point where they've done everything. They just get so chilled and relaxed. You know, they don't have anything to prove. They don't have to try hard. They're just effortlessly cool. And he is one of the most effortlessly cool people I think I've ever come across. Mm. And we were at the Foo Fighters' own recording studio, which is permanently set up for them to just go and do whatever they want to do whenever. They've got their own sort of little man cave. There is a massive picture on the wall which is of the women on bikes at Wimbledon Stadium from the bicycle race video.
Oh, wow.
It's huge, it's fantastic. So a great man cave basically for the Foo Fighters. And we'd done the interview and the guys were putting the camera equipment away and he just started chatting away and he just said, he mentioned Doing All Right. He said, I love that track. He said, it's one of my favourite tracks. He said, I actually got a little band that I'm in that we just play local gigs whenever the Foos aren't doing anything, just to keep me occupied. And he said, and we do Doing All Right. Do you want to hear it? And it was like, well, yes, of course I do, Mr. Hawkins. So he played it and it sounded amazing. And he just said, they should absolutely be doing this track live because in Adam, they have someone who can sing it. He could do those lyrics.
Yeah.
He could do that.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the range. So they absolutely should. He said, I've told Brian that they should put it in the set. He said, so next time you see Brian, tell him that I said he's got to do Doing All Right. And I'm like, yeah, of course, because Brian listens to me. No problem. Yeah, absolutely. Anyway, about 3 months later, I am sat with Brian and showing him the cut of the documentary for him to sort of give his feedback on it. And I took the plunge and I said at the end, I said, oh, by the way, you know, Taylor was great. Loved meeting Taylor. He mentioned that he'd been on at you to include Doing All Right in the set list. But, oh, yeah, he has mentioned that. Yeah. I don't know. It's not a big, big hit. So, you know, when we're in those shows, you know, it's got to compete with the big hits. And I said, well, no, it's not a big hit, but it does have the virtue of being in the movie, Bohemian Rhapsody, the movie. It's the song that Freddie auditions. I said, so a lot of people are going to know it now that perhaps didn't beforehand. He went, yeah, and just did that thing where he just goes, and nothing more was said. And I was so thrilled when I saw clips of their tour that they did at the beginning of 2020 before we all went into lockdown. They were over in Asia and Australasia, and Doing All Right is in the set. And they do it, and it's so good. And I am not...
Also, I'll hear it when I go see him live next
year. Yes, if it's still in the set, it will be there. And I am in no way claiming that I was the one that persuaded them to do it. I think Taylor Hawkins can absolutely claim that. And plus many others, I imagine. But
I think you're the one that tipped the scale.
Well,
I think that's the exclusive that's going to get this podcast in the press.
I agree.
The moment that
Simon Lupton reveals key role in getting early Queen song into Queen plus Adam Lambert tour. Shocker.
Yes.
If not the press, certainly at least a press. One press.
One press. But it's that kind of thing, is it? I'm going to claim it if it's a success. But if it's a disaster, I had nothing to do with it.
That is a glorious story. Shall we listen to a bit of Doing Well?
Please.
I'm actually going to jump in when it goes calypso, because where the hell did that come from?
Should be waiting for the sun, looking round to find the words to say. Should be waiting for the skies to clear, fill the time in all the world.
So you've got this really mellow bass track to kick off with, and then it goes all this playful stuff, and then I think the bit that everyone loves, it does rock out before this, but I'm going to go to the
that bit. Yeah. Suze, is that Freddie in falsetto there?
Yeah, it is, and it's so smooth. I could talk for hours on Freddie's voice, and
please
I
do.
Think we've I can another time. But he's got this incredible baritone where he can go up into falsetto, but it doesn't sound like he's flipping his voice into another register. It just all sounds like it's clean all the way up, and I never tire of hearing that, because in the same song, and not just on the same album, in the same song, he'll do a full belt on those same notes, but it doesn't sound like a different voice. It's amazing.
But as Queen went on, he did less falsetto, didn't he? Because if you listen to the Golders Green gig, when they're doing I think Father to Son, there's a falsetto note that he did in the early gigs, but as they played that song more, he stops doing it,
right?
Which
he
I
goes
thought
for
was
a
like
harder sound.
I wonder if he, as the gigs got bigger, he needed to embrace the more sort of powerful
I wonder,
part of his
yeah,
range.
And I wonder if he made that all part of his persona, because he could obviously still do it. Because in Wembley '86, they do that sort of impromptu is the track, and they're sort of riffing around, and he's up there on a top B flat, which is crazy high. Mm. So he can obviously still do it right across his career. I wonder if he made it part of his whole persona that he would sing less wisperly, I guess, if that's the way he saw it. Yeah.
Well, I think he, because he wasn't actually, didn't have singing lessons, I think that as tours go on, his voice gets in worse condition.
Probably.
So he dodges out of some trickier notes.
Yeah.
Because if you kind of watch him, technically, he doesn't sing very well technically,
nothing about it should work.
although
singing in a falsetto is easier than singing that hard mid-range belting that he did. Mm. That's much easier on the voice up there. But I wish I could ask him.
I think also
I'm such a like vocal technique nerd. I'm obsessed with it. I'm really interested in it.
I think also he had Roger to fall back on in the live, that Roger could just naturally do the high stuff.
Who has never lost that top range.
No, it's extraordinary.
And a full sound. Yeah.
Oh, that's wonderful. Shall we actually listen to that little bit of what you're talking about? That amazing sort of move from
Harlan
to what a move! To take that, you know, it's the most. It's one of the most relaxing mellow songs. I just adore this song so much. Relaxing mellow song, goes all playful and calypso, and that turns out to be just the most amazing hard rock riff. One of the best hard rock riffs ever. It's an incredible move. It's a song that has everything in it. It's what we've been talking about a lot today. Even our fan guy John Worsley, when he was talking about all the different types of music you can get in an album, you're getting it all in one song here. It's crazy.
You can see they're experimenting. It's kind of this song I always think makes me think of the Millionaire's Waltz, when they do the same thing. They're using this the same melodies and chords, but it's like they've made a whole different genre within the song.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask. So when you have songs like this, which feel like they have completely different sections almost stitched together, they're not stitched together. They are blended. So are there like things going on technically that hold this whole song?
Yeah, it's you hear Brian's playing acoustic guitar on that calypso section, and then he essentially is playing the same rhythm, notes, everything, but on a hard electric sound. It shouldn't work, and it works.
Yeah, it's
same with everything with Queen.
It's amazing.
I think also something we're going to come back to quite a lot is Brian's ability to play very melodic guitar solos. Mm. That whereas for most bands, it sounds like, right now it's time for a guitar solo, yeah, and it sort of doesn't bear much relation to the song, apart from it's being in the same key, it's someone showing off. But his solos are sort of counter melodies in themselves.
Completely.
That I think is really important in stitching those different sections of songs together without feeling you're ever leaving the song at any one time.
Yeah. I can't remember. I think it's in one of your docket. It might have been Days of Their Lives, but someone somewhere, it's in my head somewhere, said that a Brian May solo is the only kind of guitar solo you can actually sing along with.
Yeah.
You can sing along.
That's,
which is massive, right?
Yeah.
Well, I think he writes a lot of them on the piano and then transposes them to the guitar. Mm. So that would be part of the reason why. But also he never outstays his welcome,
right,
ever.
Right, right.
Like, if I think in all of rock music, if you give someone 16 bars or 32 bars and say, right, there's your bit, he's the person you would go to be able to pack so much into that.
Yeah.
Do you include his live guitar solos in that?
Well, the clever thing the other members of the band have done, have gone, Brian, have your bit.
Right,
bit,
yeah, of course, yeah, yeah.
We'll go and have a fag and a pint of Heineken.
Yeah.
Or, you know, in those moments, Rick Wakeman actually has a curry during his show. So Rick Wakeman always has a curry halfway through his gig.
That's amazing. But
that's the moment where Brian can kind of be the fullest version of himself as an electric guitarist. But what that means is he has that moment and then is able to be constrained in the songs, whereas someone perhaps like, you know, all great guitarists like Slash or Steve Vai, whoever, kind of noodling on for ages.
Actually, I've got to invoke producer Giles on this bit of it. Giles, could you just explain for us how Richie Sambora works in Bon Jovi, please?
They have him on a loop in a cupboard. Basically, Richie Sambora lives in a cupboard. He just keeps playing guitar, and when they need a solo from him, they open the door, shove the mic in. When they've got enough solo, they shut the door again. He loves it, apparently.
When I was reading about this, I love the story about someone saying that when Brian did one of his first sort of guitar solos in those early concerts, and you know, he was playing with the delay, and you know, he plays a bit and it bounces around, the audience were looking for the second guitarist. And I just love this idea that he's playing away and there are people out there going, who else is playing?
Wow.
They just couldn't get their heads around the fact that it was him doing
that's
it.
That's such a flattering thing to hear.
It is, it? Yeah. Like, completely
full. It is.
He plays like two people.
Yeah.
You know, like in the top, maybe this is a discussion for another podcast, but you know, whenever it comes up in the top five guitarists of all time, Brian isn't necessarily always included in those things. And you, when you actually look at the stuff that he was doing, on every level, he's pushing the envelope, right? He's incredibly, you know, and you talk to guitarists and they all love him.
Yeah. Well, he is to guitar what Freddie is to singing, in that he's got his very definite voice, but he can lend it to anything, any genre, and where Freddie has the same thing. He's got this unmistakably Freddie voice, but he can lend it to any genre.
I think the reason he's not in a lot of those sort of high up in a lot of those lists, apart from Total Guitar, who recently voted in the greatest guitarist of all time.
It's about time. Because Freddie's always number one on singers.
But it's, I think that he's the best composing guitarist in pop and rock, but he's not, and I don't think he's ever tried to be like a virtuoso.
Right.
So even though he has moments of really complex playing, if you're a guitar dweeb, which I count myself as, so can use that phrase, you do get a kick out seeing someone doing like a really, like an insane Metallica solo that goes on for a couple of minutes. But that was never his role to play. Mm. And I think credit to him that he perhaps reined in his entire potential as an electric guitarist to make the songs themselves work.
Mm. Yeah, music came first.
Yeah,
that's brilliant. Yeah, yeah. I'm just going to, before we move off Doing All Right, I'm just going to touch base with the fact that, and we mentioned it, but Doing All Right was originally a Smile song with Tim Staffel. And I think, again, you know, it's a lovely version. Tim's voice is lovely, but, you know, Freddie makes the song so distinctive, so very Queen. It just brings this huge pomp into it. And I actually dug out an album called Amigo that was released in 2005 by Tim Staffel, and it's got Brian on it. Brian's joined him to play, and they play this version of Doing All Right on it. That's actually, it's almost like easy listening. It's an absolute, it's a completely different version of the song. It's sort of got that sort of, it's actually quite nice and bouncy. It's got almost a country feel to it.
Yeah. Well, he still got a royalty for many years for Doing All Right, which I think's a really nice move. Mm.
Yeah.
I think he's said in one interview he'd sort of earned $20,000 in 20 years for Doing All Right, which I think is quite sweet.
Cool.
Because they wouldn't legally have had to do that, I don't think.
Right. No, he's still credited, isn't he, as a co-writer on it, and I think that's great.
There's a lovely YouTube clip of him out in Japan quite recently. He seems, you know, the same age as the rest of the guys, and it's just him in a little room full of these wonderful Japanese kids that are absolutely rapt as he plays it, just him and his guitar. And then every time they go, you reach the chorus, the whole room, they're silent throughout the whole thing, just watching him. And then every time they reach the chorus, the whole room just goes, Doing All Right. And it's so sweet. It's so lovely. You should definitely check that out if you can find it. So, our next feature point is News of the World. Come on, honey. Now, this is a podcast, so if you want up-to-date current news about Queen, we recommend going to a thing they have now called the internet. That will give you much more up-to-date information. All we're really talking about is just stuff that Queen happened to be doing at the point of recording, and we thought might be fun to chat about. A good example is, at this point, I think a week ago, maybe even a little bit later than that, I was tickled to find that they have, the Royal Mail are issuing a stamp collection of Queen. And Roger's reaction really tickled me, because he's quoted as saying, I guess we're part of the furniture now, which is an amazing response to being on a bunch of stamps.
Can I give my Queen stamp fact now?
Oh, yes. Please. The ideal time for your Queen stamp fact.
I mean, everyone's got a Queen stamp fact, but I'm pretty keen on mine. Simon might be able to tell me whether this is true. So, Tony Benn, so the Queen stamp fact starts with Tony Benn,
right,
who was then,
I love it already,
who was then Postmaster General in the past.
I love that man.
And he had to persuade the Queen that it was about time that other images could appear on stamps apart from the royal head, the royal sort of profile. And it was to do commemorative stamps, I think, about maybe the Olympics or Concord, or basically wanted to broaden the stamp world out to create sort of fun, cool ones. And eventually, after showing lots and lots of different designs, the Queen agreed. However, there was a sticking point where they wanted to do, I think, an outline of an athlete. because the rule was that no living people could appear on stamps apart from the Queen. So the way that they overcame this was by doing a sort of an artist's impression of an athlete. So it wasn't a specific living person, it was just an outline. Fast forward 20 years or so, and this rule is still in place that you can put stuff on stamps, but it can't be living people. And they did a commemorative set in the 90s with a picture of Freddie Mercury on stage. So having sadly died, it was okay to put him on the stamp because you could commemorate people who'd passed away. However, the person who set that stamp either didn't notice or wasn't aware of the rule, because in the background, Roger Taylor is on drums, which I'm pretty sure meant that Roger Taylor is the first ever living person to appear on a British stamp other than the reigning monarch.
Oh, that is badass.
And the link is cool.
That is a badass stamp fact.
Thanks, man.
That's blown my mind.
This is the only time people have got more interested as the anecdote went on and not less interested. But so, is that true? Do you know that fact, Simon?
It is. You're absolutely right. It is true. It was 1999, and it was funny because the stamp caused controversy. A, because Roger, and I think to this day, remains the only living person who's not a member of the royal family to be on a stamp. But also, the Daily Mail waged a campaign against it, I believe, because they thought it was celebrating Freddie's reprehensible lifestyle by allowing him to go on a stamp, which says more about the Daily Mail than anything you need to know.
Doesn't it? Yeah.
But yeah, no, I think that's genius. I love that story. That is so... Yeah, and you're right. I think it was a mistake. I don't think the person noticed Roger in the back, but by the time anyone pointed it out, they'd been out for a week, so nothing they could do. The defence of Royal Mail was that the Queen had seen it and approved it, so therefore it was her fault. I thought it was brilliant.
So is that... Because these stamps that have come out obviously feature living people on them.
Yeah, they're just they're commemorative collector's editions. They're not legal stamps. You can't use them to...
Right.
From what I understand, you can't use them to post. They are just for collectors. They come in a nice...
Oh, that's it. So
presentation.
So Roger is still... the only living person outside of the royal...
That's
fantastic.
What I believe, yeah.
Wow.
That could actually legitimately be on an envelope.
Yeah. And I think he was awesome. Quite tickled with it, I imagine.
Legitimately, what's just happened in Stamp World is maybe the most dramatic event of my stamp collecting. Like, just that information about Roger has blown my... I might start collecting stamps now with
just
this
to get
collection.
Your hands on.
Well,
just
Freddie collected stamps, didn't he?
Oh, he did!
Quite a decent stamp collection. He was a philatelist. I was a numismatist as a kid, just to be cool, win favour with girls. I started collecting
numbers,
coins.
Yes, you did.
And, I eventually settled on farthings, but I was a commemorative coin guy for the first couple of years. But I do actually have a couple of Queen coins if you want to see them.
Oh, please!
I love that all of this stuff is within arm's reach of you. I imagine that people listening to this must think this is all like staged. John, is Deb just in his office, or is it your room? I don't know what your lounge. But literally behind him is like this a huge array of Queen stuff, which he obviously has perfectly filed in his head, because there's no hesitation. Just something comes up and he goes, "Well, I've just got a thing for this," and he grabs it. It's there. This is crazy. We had no idea we were going to talk about...
Well, wait until... Because we're talking about early Queen. Wait until we have to dive into not one, but two copies of Queen in Cornwall.
Oh, Queen in Cornwall.
What is that? You literally produced that out of nowhere. Why do you have two copies? I don't even want to know.
I've got two copies of Queen in Cornwall.
Right.
Because... I was sent a copy when I used to do a show on Radio X. I was sent a copy by, I think, the son of the guy who wrote it.
Oh.
It's by Rupert White. And where's my other copy? my other copy's upstairs because I was reading it. And the other copy a friend found in a secondhand shop and bought for me. I think I'm the only person apart from the author to own two copies of Queen in Cornwall. It is... a remarkable... well, let me say this. If you're not interested in Queen in Cornwall, do not read this book. It really does what it says on the tin.
What were they doing in Cornwall?
It's basically because an awful lot of their early gigs leading up to Queen One were in Cornwall, because Roger used to run, he used to actually promote shows down there on a sort of quite a small scale. So their first ever gig was in Truro.
Right.
He was known as the best drummer in Cornwall for a while and stuff like that.
That's right, yeah.
All that kind of stuff.
Well, there are some really nice photos in here of, I mean, the archiving in here is just remarkable, because the guy who wrote it has access to an awful lot of the people who were in bands that supported them or who were in bands with Roger. So there's some incredible little sort of, you know, like, here, I'll show you here. This was useless, but these are all the early Smile playbills.
Oh, wow.
Oh, that is lovely.
And one of them introduces Cornwall's legendary drummer Roger Taylor plus Queen. But amazingly, for a book called Queen in Cornwall, it's so in-depthly detailed about the early Smile shows and Roger shows that you don't actually get to Queen until the penultimate chapter.
Flipping hell.
So there's about 200 pages of early proto-Queen in Cornwall before you actually get to Queen in Cornwall. But there's some cool stuff like... Oh, here we go. There you go. So that's the legendary drummer of Cornwall, Roger Taylor...
And Queen.
And tiny Queen. Little letters, Queen.
Yeah. Tiny little letters,
sorry,
Queen.
Before you go on, John, I'm just making a mental note about, write a book, Queen in Hertfordshire.
Yeah. You'll be able to make a farthing.
There's an early contract that they signed that was saved from... it says here, the contract for the concert, the College of Estate Management, St Albans Grove, signed by Brian May, for £20 for a 1 hour, 15-minute performance. The document was rescued from the archives of Moore, Sloan and Co. by Nigel Chappell. And you can see that it's obviously been like... So that's a photocopy, but it's been sort of screwed up and then ironed flat to be taken in the book.
Well, John, I'm so thrilled that you reached across for your commemorative Queen coins based
Queen
on a conversation about stamps. And now we've got a new spin-off podcast all about
Queen
in
Cornwall.
Various counties.
Different counties.
The County Queen. I thought it might be a nice idea just to talk about... the boys' Insta feed over the course of this lockdown period, just very briefly, because I think they've been wonderful, really wonderful. I mean, obviously, I know Brian's been through a bit, but I particularly the first half of lockdown, I was checking with Brian May absolutely every day, because he'd have just something wonderful. Like, he really was building a community, and it was lovely to see Roger getting in on the app. Were any of you guys following that stuff?
Yeah, I've seen some of his YouTube videos he's been doing.
I really liked with Brian how at the start of the, because I think any sort of Queen fan knows that Brian is sort of quite a sensitive chap, and at the start of the lockdown I sort of felt he seemed to be taking on quite a lot of sort of burden on his shoulders about the world, but it was so nice to see him through Instagram find it as a way not just of providing lots of content and connection with fans, but also he seemed to become a bit more confident and a bit happier in himself throughout it. I mean, obviously, then ended with problems with illness, which we all wish him well. But he just seemed so much more chipper that he found a way to kind of play licks and talk to people and feel like there was a sense of community around him through Instagram.
Yeah, I agree. In fact, we're going to indulge our producer, who's hiding in the background, which is, he's called variously Giles and Hendo and Henderson and Fergus and all sorts of things. But I'm going to call him Giles right now. Giles, you were telling me an amazing... Because Giles plays the guitar, and he jumped... Was it Bo Rat that you jumped in on, mate?
I used to, but this happened during lockdown, so I can't...
Oh,
really.
No. Oh. You've broken your guitar.
The head has come off the neck of my guitar. My Gibson has been decapitated. And it happened shortly after watching one of Brian's Play Along With Me videos. He was teaching everyone how to do the solo, the kind of mid-song, mid-speed solo from Bo Rap. And maybe it was from my frustration, but I'm so sure the last note he was playing on that play-along was incorrect. Now I'm going to assume that Brian May knows how to play Bohemian Rhapsody, right? But I don't understand. You know, the end of it, da-da-da-da-da-dum, and then he comes in with a little silhouette of the map. He was playing that, da-da-da-da-da, and it was just such a wrong note. He played it over and over again. I wanted to message him, Brian, I don't know what's going on, but that's not right. And I do have a feeling he was just being tricksy. I think
he was trolling us.
Yeah,
you don't want to be mansplaining.
Exactly.
Oh my, I've mansplained so many people in my life,
but not Brian May.
No.
Yeah, it's wonderful, wonderful stuff. Basically, we really like Brian and Roger. I think that's fair to say.
Imagine if we're like, I don't.
Oh no, Suze.
Yeah, sorry, not keen.
Shall we move on to the second half of side two, which is Great King Rat.
Great King Rat died today, born on the 21st of May. Died to put his body for on his birthday. Every second what he swore, yes, he was the son of a whore.
Now, I think there's a lot of DNA for Queen to come in this track. How do you guys? Definitely. Anyone's excited about this piece of music?
It's Freddie's first composition.
It is.
That is on an album, isn't it? It's so Freddie. It's got all that. It's got all that sort of decadence and filth. And I love, and it's so Freddie for him. It's all with a wink. Although, wouldn't you like to know?
Yeah.
Would you like to see? Yeah. It's really, yeah, it's really Freddie. I find the song like pretty funny.
Yeah.
It's really heavy as well. It's like it's probably in Queen's five heaviest tracks.
Mm, mm-hmm.
And fun fact for gear nerds: it's the only time Brian used a wah pedal absolutely extensively. And a lot of people think he uses wah when he doesn't, because what you can, so this is the only time he's using like an active wah, so actually moving the pedal. What a lot of people think Brian does in other songs is using a set wah, which is where you just, and this is something Frank Zappa, who, fun fact, introduced Jimi Hendrix to the wah pedal. Used to do is you actually set the wah and don't manipulate it during the song, but you get it on that sweet spot of the bit where it modulates the tone. But Brian doesn't need to do that because he can set the pickups on his guitar out of phase, which mimics that sound. So what another reason Brian's amazing is just how much of that sound is coming out of his fingers, his pick and the guitar, and how little extra is added onto that sound to create the sort of orchestrations. Because you listen to stuff from especially the first five albums and you think, well, that's got to be manipulated somehow, but it really isn't. It's the Red Special, it's the pickups, it's the sixpence, and it's the treble booster and the Deke amp, and that's basically it. And if you look at like rig rundowns on YouTube, so the guitarist from Skunk and Anansie, his rig will be sort of 6 foot wide, 4 foot deep desk of pedals. So it might be 20 or 30 pedals. If you look at Brian's, it's one button and that turns the treble booster on and off. And that's basically it. And everything else is actually happening on the guitar. Wow.
Because he built the damn thing
incredible
from scratch. Wow. What a unique individual. That's brilliant, John.
Yeah.
I should also point out my girlfriend shares a birthday with Great King Rat.
21st of May.
Which I only realised this year. So her birthday's the 21st of May. And I was listening to Great King Rat and I came downstairs and says, "You've got the same birthday as Great King Rat." He died of syphilis on his birthday when he was 44.
That must have gone down great. I'm amazed you're still together.
Yeah.
So the thing I've always thought about Great King, weirdly, my relationship with it is when I'm not listening to it, I don't think I like it. And then the second I start listening to it, I absolutely adore it. And it happens every time. It surprises me every time. Listen, should we listen to some of this stuff?
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Can we listen to maybe a bit of the Wah solo?
Yeah.
Just seeing as we're talking about it and it's the only time he uses it.
Show me.
I think it's interesting because Freddie was obsessed with Jimi Hendrix.
Mm.
And I think it's interesting that there isn't more Wah in their early songs because, I mean, breaks my heart that I wasn't alive at the time, but he used to follow Jimi Hendrix around the gigs he did in London,
mm-hmm.
where you could go and see him above like pubs in Camden and stuff. So it's an interesting little outlier, that guitar solo. Mm.
Yeah, and also I think there's a DNA here for We Are the Champions, because he's riffing on Old King Cole, right? The Old King Cole was a merry old soul and a merry old soul. You know, that and Champions does I'm the king of the castle, you're the dirty rascal.
Mm-hmm.
So it's that's something that's always interested me, where you were saying this earlier, Suze, where there are things in this album that are clear DNA markers for stuff that they don't know that they're going to create, that's going to become part of the lexicon of human civilization. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's not like they're one of those bands where, oh, you should hear the early stuff, you'd never guess it was Queen. There are songs that are like that, but you can all the way through their even their very earliest stuff, you can hear where the latest stuff comes from.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to play a little bit more on this. The bit that always blows my mind is when he goes full Roman in the middle of the song. Do you know the bit I mean?
Full Roman.
Yeah.
Madison, are you people? Put out the gun and keep the bed. Don't believe all you read in the Bible. You sinners get it.
I mean, there's so many sections in this song, but it's quite a why is Freddie so obsessed with the Jesus on this album, please?
Religion comes into it quite a lot, but it's always sort of questioning religion, isn't it?
Yeah,
because I mean, we'll get to this on the next episode, but Jesus, the song Jesus isn't here's a song about the Son of God. It's a song about all these people are worshiping this guy. I wonder why.
It's also
quite odd for the religion to sit so close to that fantasy, like pagan aspect of all of the Lord of the Ringsy type stuff to be maybe slightly disparaging. I don't mean it that, because as a kid I loved all of that those sort of fantasy worlds. It is interesting that it's something that they very much just stopped doing. So there's none of that really after Queen 1 and 2.
I'd say after Shit Heart Attack, because you've got Lap of the
Yeah. Well, I think it contributed to their reputation as being sort of Led Zeppelin imitators, which has stuck around to this day after being peddled by naysayers like Danny Baker. But I've got also from Queen in Cornwall, the resource that keeps on giving, is an Ibex set list.
Freddie's band from Manchester,
in Freddie's
right?
writing, but the Liverpool. He's also sketched on it some sort of ogre type figures. So if you look there,
oh wow. Look at him in the middle.
He is good at drawing though, isn't he?
Yeah,
he's a very good artist. Yeah.
He was sort of sketching fantastic figures around that time.
Yeah.
But it is perhaps a more out of fashion than out of an inherent desire to promote.
Yeah, no, I'm down
sort of,
with all the
fantasy.
You know, the fairy. Well, I mean, obviously, My Fairy King's about to discuss, and Fairy Fellas, Masterstroke, and Ogre Battle, all that stuff. Totally. I mean, Queen 2 is almost entirely a fantasy album, which is incredible. But the religion thing has always just massively surprised me, particularly out of Freddie's writing. And there's an interesting thing, I've been thinking about this a lot. maybe it's a discussion for another podcast, but why Freddie was so quiet about his cultural background, his ethnicity. Mm-hmm. And I don't know that it was a particularly brilliant time to be running around saying, I'm gay. I think that it definitely wasn't.
Oh, yeah, of course.
And actually, thinking about the fact that my parents came to this country in the late 60s, I think it was a fantastic, not necessarily a fantastic, there was a lot of people that were just absolutely blown away by people of colour and were really excited mm-hmm. by them. And, you know, my parents had that as an experience more than any other. But certainly when you're putting yourself front and centre to be a massive pop and rock star, I wonder if that might have, and this is pure conjecture, pure wondering of whether it was something he kept quiet about because, you know, unfortunately people were quite resistant to people of colour at that time.
Well, and he had been on the receiving end of racism.
Had he?
Hadn't he? Yeah, working in Heathrow.
Oh, yeah.
So, very possibly he just went, well,
I'll just keep quiet about
it. Not mention it. I'll just be Freddie Mercury and that will...
Possibly.
But also, I mean, today, indie and rock music is still, you know, remarkably white. But even more so if you think about Asian and brown acts as opposed to just non-white. I mean, how many examples would there have been in Freddie's world of Indian or African singers in rock? Right. Mm. I mean, it would be zero and a handful today.
You were still 20 years away from Corner Shop.
Yeah, it's amazing to think of.
It's even more reason why he would follow Hendrix around gigs then.
Right. Mm. It's true.
That sort of is a bit of an insight into... Oh, yeah, that would appeal to him.
And I suppose what I was getting back to was that maybe embracing these ideas of Christianity and stuff, that it possibly helped with a mask, if there was one. I don't know. Who can know? Out of thoroughness, I'm going to mention Mad the Swine here, which is only because they were going to put it in between Great King Rat and My Fairy King, which is a track that Freddie wrote.
All you children gather around, come join your hands and sing along. Guess I'm
Mad the Swine.
I've come to save you, save you.
Mad the Swine, Mad the Swine.
So all you people
gather around,
hold out your hands and praise the Lord.
They didn't include it because they weren't happy with the sound recording of it, which is awesome. We're just not happy with the sound recording of it, so we're not going to put it in. And that's how fastidious they were. Didn't come out until a B-side in 91 on the Headlong album, which was Innuendo Times. So that's a long old wait. And I think at that point they put it in as an extra track on a new version of the Queen 1 album. So I guess if you pick up the deluxe version, you do have it. But
I think it sounds like a smile song if you listen to Mad the Swine more than anything on the album. So I think whether by luck or design, I think it's right that it isn't on the album actually. Because when you listen to it now in context, it feels more like those earlier smile songs like Blag and Polar Bear and April Lady and that kind of thing.
It's another one that's bizarrely religious, isn't it? Mad the Swine.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But nothing to do with Freddie. Yeah.
Yeah, crazy. Let's do a quick feature point we're calling Now Who's Here?
Now I'm here. Think I stay around, 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 around. Down in the city, just to you and me.
Simon, quite wonderfully has the ability to find lots and lots of juicy things from all these wonderful documentaries he's made around about Queen. We're hoping he'll get to share with us. And I think you found a couple of bits that you wanted to share with us for this album, yes? Or at least the first half of this album.
Yeah, well, I just thought it'd be nice to hear the band talking about their first album. And thanks to Greg Brooks, who is the keeper of the Queen archive, which it's very difficult to get into at the moment, given lockdown. But bless him, he sort of came up trumps and he sent me some interviews that the band gave. So this was an interview they gave in 1977, but looking back at those early days with Queen, and particularly the sort of around this this first album. And I think what's really striking is when we talk about this album is that the songs that, that appeared on this first album, they Queen had been living with for about 3 years before the album actually came out. It was the songs they'd written. Some of them were came out of Smile, or sort of the embryos for them might have been with Freddie's bands, or Ibex or Wreckage. So they'd sort of existed in some shape or form for a long time, and they played them live. So for them, it felt like it'd taken them a long time. But anyway, I'll let the band talk about that rather than me. So this,
wow, what a treat.
So yeah, so this is a little clip for you.
Roger, can we go to the beginnings of the group? You and Freddie were working, or you had a stall right in the Kensington market.
Yes, partners in crime.
Partners in crime.
Yes, it was really just, it was more of a sort of social centre, I think, at the time. At the time, that Queen was sort of in its formative stages, and we were going through all their traumas with trying to find somebody to manage us and find a record company, etc. We sort of slogged our way around, made some demo tapes, etc., through some friends, and then sort of hawked them round the business, as it was, and still is, eventually sort of securing ourselves several companies who were interested. We then did a gig, I think it was at King's College, somewhere down in South London, and got a load of record companies along. And then we started to sort of try and wheel and deal a bit our way into a sort of good recording situation.
How long did it take you from the time that you'd made the demo to the time that you actually got a recording contract?
It felt like about 80 years, I think.
It was a long time. It was about 2 years.
Yeah, it was about 18 months, 2 years, yeah.
There was a great deal of feeling of frustration at the time. The first album was really old songs by the time it came out, as far as we were concerned. And it put us in a strange position because there were a lot of... We were sort of one of the groups who came along with a show and a sort of an idea of a complete production as a stage show and everything. Whereas by the time the record came out, and particularly by the time it got played by anyone and all this, I mean, it takes so long to get things going, it was all sounding like old news, you know, so people were inclined to tag us as the tail end of glitter rock or something.
There you go. So yeah,
the theme is developing. This is exactly what you were talking about, that Queen essentially formed, you know, 50th anniversary is next year, but you know, everything at the beginning was so slow to get going, right? They've been sat with this album for so long.
That's right.
I've been reading a lot about that period in the run-up to recording this podcast. I would like to perhaps provide a slight counterpoint, because there was so... I think he's certainly right in that that album could really be called, like, Queen the Early Years could be the name of that album, because it's sort of a compilation of everything that they'd sort of picked up since the late 60s. But if you think that John joined the band in March 1971, Queen 1 was released just over 2 years later, and by the end of 1973, in the September, they were being recorded by the BBC, a live gig. If you gave any new band the option of having a record deal and an album out and being recorded by the BBC within 2 years of finalising your sort of lineup, I think most band would absolutely snap your arm off. Mm. And also, they were offered a recording contract earlier with Chrysalis,
which they turned down,
for I think 20 grand, which goodness knows what that's worth in today's money. Mm. And I think it shows enormous vision that they did turn that down, but also that they essentially stopped gigging. So if you look at the, as Simon mentioned, queenconcerts.com is a brilliant resource. It's basically every gig they ever did. Mm-hmm. But they did 21 gigs between John joining and Queen 1 coming out, which in terms of like a sort of a jobbing band is a very small amount.
Yeah,
they
nothing.
Did barely any in 1972, which I think was when they were trying to get the right record deal in place. And the first of the gigs they did to sort of promote Queen One was the Golders Green gig, which there is a recording of that the BBC made, which I only discovered this week, and because it's on YouTube, and I think we might talk about it later.
Yeah, yeah, you shared it.
It's a phenomenal artifact.
Yeah.
So yeah, obviously for them, very frustrating having, because you forget everyone in the 60s was in a band, so they'd all been in bands for 10 years, say, you know, 7 or 8 years. So it was the end of a long process, sure, personally, but in terms of kind of like four guys getting together, then getting a recording contract, then getting an album out, it's not ages. It's not like Pulp.
No, I suppose.
You know, Pulp didn't make it for about 15 years.
Yeah, or Elbow.
But I wonder to what extent that album essentially being behind their own times, if that's not too much of a sort of contrived way of saying it, containing stuff that to them was maybe a couple of years out of date. I wonder to what extent that set the tone with critics never quite getting on board with them totally.
That's an interesting point.
Yeah.
And I wonder if they never sort of lost that reputation for being sort of slightly after the curve, even though Queen 2, you could tell how desperate they were to move on because those live gigs to promote Queen 1 already had half of the stuff from Queen 2 in, and Queen 2 came out in what? You know,
it's like
it was months
later or something, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, that Golders Green gig was, there was so much Queen 2 material on there and only a couple of tracks off the first album. I'm going to ask Simon, is there another clip you wanted to play us? Or?
Yeah, I'll just play another bit later on in the interview where they talk about then what happened when the album actually finally got onto the shelves and particularly after Keep Yourself Alive had been released as a single.
Keep Yourself Alive, your first single. Brian, were you disappointed that this didn't do better?
Oh, yes. It takes me back very vividly to the time, actually, because this is just the time when we started. We did a few gigs on our own, some small gigs, and then went on the support tour with Mott the Hoople, and went around the whole country getting really good reactions and thinking, yeah, we're really getting somewhere. And yet all the time we were watching the single and the album and nothing appeared anywhere in the charts, you know. And it just seemed like an impossible wall. We thought, how is it done? You know, we couldn't get the single played on the radio at all, hardly. Well, there's a couple of people that played it, but it didn't get any sort of power play. But there's no doubt that the beginning is the worst. You know, you have no track record, you have no reputation.
Tough times, yeah, you know, wow. But it wasn't an overnight success. I mean, John's absolutely right. It was, looking back on it, it was a time scale that I think any band would kill for. But it wasn't something that just they suddenly rocked up and then they were huge. There was a lot of graft, there was a lot of, you know, chipping away and a lot of frustration at how long it was taking. But I think what's interesting there is that when people were seeing them live, from what Brian was saying there, they're getting it and people are going, this is something extraordinary. And I think that's been them their whole career, that if you see them live, you get them much more than if you just listen to the albums. I think, you know, they are consummate studio recorders, but they are such a great live act.
Phenomenal musicians. Yeah, absolutely. I've got to ask, you don't happen to know who that interviewer is? Was it for the BBC?
Yeah, it was a guy called Tom Brown, I think, yeah.
I'm just thinking, like, that's such a classic sort of 70s and 80s BBC radio voice. And you think, God, all the voices on Six Music now.
Yeah.
No one sounds like that anymore, which is progress. No. Don't get me wrong, that is progress.
No, and if you can get access to
it's like a duvet.
The Queen on Air box set that came out, I think it was a couple of years ago, the whole interview is on there and it's great. It's really worth. And they just talk about all of their career up to that point, which then was 1977. So it's well worth listening. Wow. But yeah, he's the most un-rock and roll type person to interview them, wasn't it?
All right, so shall we move on to My Fairy King?
Which yes, please.
Yeah.
Someone strain the colour from my wings. Broken my fairy circle ring. And shame the king in all his pride.
Mother Mercury, look what they've done to me. I cannot run, I cannot hide.
I would like to know what the significance of this lyric is. Someone has just drained the colour from my wings, broken my fairy circle ring.
Well, it's sort of unambiguous, really, isn't it? It's amazing. I think it is. shamed the king in all his pride. And then, like, two lines later, he's going, Mother Mercury.
Mother Mercury, yeah.
I mean, that's surely that's barely cloaking him coming out and his complicated feelings around that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, certainly it's this mention of Mercury in this song, and then also he mentions Mercury again in Liar, I think. But that's allegedly where he sort of turned to Brian and went, right, I'm going to call myself Freddie Mercury from this point, right?
Looking back with hindsight, he's got so many coming out songs.
Yeah.
That none of them are quite coming out songs, but if you want to sort of put that hindsight onto them, you know, son and daughter.
Mm.
I mean, he didn't necessarily write all of these songs, but with his
influence,
with his treatment, you can't help but read them through that lens.
That's it,
I mean,
yeah.
some of the
lyrics from My Fairy King come from, in fact, the opening line comes from a poem by Robert Browning.
Oh, okay.
Called The Pied Piper of Hamelin. So this is from the 13th stanza of that poem.
Let's hear the stanza.
Yeah. The sparrows were brighter than the peacocks here, and their dogs outran our fallow deer, and honeybees had lost their stings, and horses were born with eagles' wings.
Oh, wow.
So that's from The Pied Piper of Hamelin,
right?
Which was written in the 19th century.
There you go.
Presumably on lots of opium.
Yeah. Can only hope.
That's great. These guys have got serious degrees going on. They've read books. They've read books. It's
weird, though, isn't it? There's a lot of the song seems like Freddie's singing about an idealised version of himself, calling himself a king. As he said, can do right and nothing wrong. It's like he's wrestling with a version of himself that he would love to be and a version of himself that he's worried that he is. I don't know. It's but also it's a really cool prog song.
Yeah, it really is. And it's got so many movements. Should we listen to some bits of it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
People are always amazed by how many movements there are in Bohemian Rhapsody, but these guys have been doing this from the word go, right?
Best song on the album, without a shadow of a doubt.
It's the best song on the album for you.
And my favourite two moments on the album are in that clip you played. So the the bit where there's the counter, sort of the counter melody where he's going, he rules the air, and then there's the bit on the top. Yeah.
For you and me.
That's my favourite moment on the album. And the bass. Oh, the bass going into that. Incredible.
Yeah.
Another great thing about this is in Doing All Right, Brian played the piano because he sort of helped write the song with Tim Staffel. So he was like, I'm playing the piano. And the legend is that when he heard Freddie's piano playing on My Fairy King, it was like, okay, from now on, Freddie does the piano playing.
Oh, really?
And Brian talks really passionately about how brilliant Freddie's piano playing was. And it's because, you know, when you're taught to play the piano, it's about keeping your wrists up, you know, and your fingers. Whereas Freddie, if you watch him live, his wrists are down, you know. And Brian says that gives him so much more power, to the point that his piano playing is becomes like a metronome. It is so rigid and, you know, powerful. And when you listen to that and you just hear that thumping of the piano, it's absolutely doing that, keeping time. And it's spot on. I mean, he, as well as being a brilliant songwriter, a brilliant singer, a brilliant performer, it turns out he's a genius on the piano as well. Who knew?
Yes.
Can we concede that when he plays guitar on Crazy Little Thing Called Love at Live Aid, maybe he shouldn't be the first choice guitarist?
Well, it's a fine line, isn't it?
This guitar never plays the chords I wanted to play.
Why does he play it?
Despite
on
the Duke Edney come along after that point.
It's it reminds
that metronomic piano bit, the din that is, that foreshadows Killer Queen and Bohemian Rhapsody there. I got a lot of Bohemian Rhapsody from that from that piano.
Yeah.
That's why it's the best song on the album.
Yeah, it is. It's such an incredible song, because this song is relentless, but it still manages to build. You never go, oh, it's got nowhere left to go, because it always goes somewhere. And then we have this slow section, and then it builds to this minute-long instrumental at the end. And it's like, oh, I'm having a heart attack over here. It's so good. It's so good how he... I don't have a mind that can layer instruments like that. I'm a real bad arranger, but how he heard, I'm going to layer all the instrumentation like this is mind blowing to me.
It's
crazy.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm half tempted to play the final minute. but you at home should find it on your iTunes or Spotify, whatever, and listen to this track. It is an incredible track. And you're right. I think the blueprint for what's to come is all in here. It's also just, it's such an astonishing group. For me, one of Freddie's like monster songs is on Queen 2 on the Black Side, which is March of the Black Queen. It's a monster. It has so many, there's so many melodies in that track that each of them deserve to be a song in their own right. And My Fairy King, it absolutely has that, you know, the joy of that, ba 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 ba, you know, and it's such a wow.
Mitch Benn, the comedian who some people might know from Radio 4, said one of my favourite ever things about Bohemian Rhapsody. He said, "What's amazing about Bohemian Rhapsody is not that it's 5 minutes 55 seconds long; it's that it's only 5 minutes 55 seconds long."
That's so good.
That's so true of an awful lot of the early Queen tracks, is these aren't 12-minute prog epics in three parts like a lot of bands were doing at the time. These are four and a half minute songs where you're actually going through all of those movements and all of those phases and all of those different parts, and it's the same length as like a Beatles track.
Right.
Or maybe slightly longer.
Right.
But they're not sort of sprawling. You know, a lot of prog bands were doing one track was the first half of the album and stuff like that.
Well,
Queen were able to condense that.
And it's just the blend of their sort of, like you were saying, Suze, their orchestration is this orchestral sound. Almost there's choral bits in it that are just as accomplished as any choir can do.
Yeah.
It's got this baroque feel to it and then this massively poppy feel to it, all in one glorious sound that just makes you feel good.
Yeah, well, something that's thrown at Queen I've heard quite often is how they were really self-indulgent, and going back to that, that's brilliant from Mitch, but it's the opposite, they weren't, and that's how that's how they didn't that's end really up being a King Crimson style band.
Yeah, yeah, no, you're absolutely right. Compared to Yes, they were not indulgent.
More like No. take that, Yes.
Yeah, Yes.
That'll show them.
There's nothing wrong with Yes, by the way. But yeah, no, like, no, bands like that, they were constantly trying to, you know, Sparks tried to poach Brian or Roger at one point, you know what I mean? And they were always like, no, we're good with Queen, thanks. And for good damn reason, this song is absolutely
phenomenal.
So this brings us finally to so obviously we'll look at Liar, Night Comes Down, Modern Times Rock and Roll, Son and Daughter, Jesus and Seven Seas Arrive on the next episode, so there's that to look forward to. So our next feature section point place is something I've called Made for Heaven.
Made in Heaven, Made in Heaven.
Now this is the exciting bit, so you listener can think, well, I want to make a Queen playlist. Now obviously you can make a wider Queen playlist from what you've listened to today. I think there's a lot of tracks you can put in. You can have the singles for free if you want. But if you want to make a creme de la creme thing.
Do you mean, are you trying to get to Queen de
Queen
la
Queen? De Queen de la Queen, thank you. Obviously.
I don't hate it.
Give it 10 weeks and you will.
Queen de la Queen playlist. Perfect. So we're going to have a quick chat about which of these tracks should be the one track that you put in your Queen de la Queen. I mean, I think you put the whole side into your generic Queen playlist, right? But
that's the thing, isn't it? Any one of these would be worthy contenders. I think that's what's
how do you not include any one of these?
No, I mean, I was all set when we sort of talked about this. I was all set to wave the flag for Doing All Right because I absolutely love that track. But do we really need to discuss? It's My Fairy King, isn't it? It's based on what we've just talked about.
I really hope it is.
Of course,
I
mean, it is.
They could all be in it, but how do you make a case for it not being My Fairy King? And I can't think of one.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? It's like, it's not the, like, if you told someone, on the first album of Queen, there's this great song called My Fairy King, you've got to hear. Like, who's going to even take you seriously? And actually, the Queen One sound is very often, there's a track on the second side of the album that I always use to kind of like, listen to this, these guys are cool. Like, whatever you think of them, however commercial they've become or whatever, if you want to see how cool these guys are, I'll take something off Queen One. But it's never My Fairy King. So why is My Fairy King better than Keep Yourself Alive, Doing All Right and Great King Rap that you must have on the first in your playlist?
Well, like Simon says, these that could be another feature.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm writing that down as well.
It just means you all have to do what
you,
they say.
When you see it as a side, it kind of feels like they're all greatest hits now that we've talked about them for an hour or two. But for me personally, I get the biggest emotional reaction from My Fairy King, and it does feel like the biggest harbinger of what's to come, especially on Queen 2. And I think there's an awful lot more pathos on this album than there are in the later albums.
Yeah.
And I think you could probably say the same of Queen 2, but there are really fragile moments and they're really quite sad laments almost. And that moment in My Fairy King, amongst all of the sort of bombast and the layering of Freddie just sort of saying, you know, look what they've done to me. I cannot run. I cannot hide. It's just, whoa, you're suddenly feeling a real emotional connection. And if when I used to ruin parties by playing early Queen, you know, when everyone else wanted to put on, when everyone else was sort of wanting to put on stuff that had been released in the last 20 years, I would always put on My Fairy King just to kind of annoy them. So for me, I just think it's the fullest example of Queen's entire breadth in one track from this side.
Definitely. I used to do that as well. And my first boyfriend, it was horrible. he threw Queen 1 on CD from the CD player after the third time I'd put it on at a party, because I'm an imp. And then he put on Disturbed, but I wasn't allowed to throw that out. So I think what I'm getting to is I won.
Yeah. Where
I was right.
Yeah.
Not far
from here, actually.
He's doing a Disturbed.
Yeah. Yeah. But he's doing it from...
Three times she put this on.
He's doing it from under a quilt. So, all right, My Fairy King. It has to be My Fairy King. In your Queen de la Queen playlist immediately, and then put all the other tracks in your Queen playlist.
Yeah.
That is what we are here for. So that brings us to the end of the first episode of the Queen Pod, which is awesome. So thank you, guys. Thank you, all of you. It's been amazing. It's
pleasure.
Such a joy. So, listen, guys, I'm going to thank you, and I can't wait to see you for side B of this album. And I'm going to also say to you, listener, please drop us a line, queenpod@thequeenpodcast.com. If you've got any comments about how, like, we've probably said things that have incensed you, you can just get it off your chest, send it to us. We will absorb it and then ignore it, and it will never see the light of day. But if you have lovely things to say, then, you know, do the likes on the podcasty thing so that we know that people are actually enjoying the podcast, and leave a review and send us, you know, just how you got into Queen, why you love My Fairy King more than any other song Queen's ever done, anything like that. If you've got a question for us to debate, we will ruin that for you as well. So do that.
And if you've got a really deep fact you want to ask for Simon Says, because we have access to Queen's official archivist.
Yeah.
I think if you've got something that's all what you've always wanted to know, then we can do Simon Says.
Because we suspect he's phoning it in, and I think we've really got to challenge him to actually find out, like, what make of black nail polish did Freddie wear when he was playing live?
Bieber.
Oh, it was Bieber. Yeah, we do.
Yeah, we do. That's page one, though. But yes, do please like this. Do please comment on it, because Queen management are very kindly letting us get away with this, which they will continue to do if they think people enjoy it and like it. If they get a sense no one's listening, we'll be out on our ear before you know it.
Yeah, and like carrying on without the music is just leaving in all the worst bits.
Yes, exactly. We need the music.
We do need the music. This is such a joy to be able to use the tunes, and we're very grateful to it. So queenpod@thequeenpodcast.com and @thequeenpod on Twitter and Insta. Does that do us?
Yeah. Yay. See you next time.
See you next time.
Bye.
This has been The Queen Pod, a Seven Seas Films production, edited and produced by me, Fergus March. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and stay in touch by emailing queenpod@thequeenpodcast.com. Thanks for listening, and see you next time.